Hello everyone, welcome to our Olympic Physical Education YouTube channel. Today we are discussing about physiology and injuries in sports. First, discussing about physiological factors determining components of physical fitness. Physiological factors. Physical fitness is referred as attributes that people have or achieve relating to their ability to perform physical activity. It is also known as ability to person to participate in a variety of physical activities efficiently. There are five components of physical fitness: strength, speed, endurance, flexibility, and coordination. And these components represent how to fit the body is as a whole. These fitness components grow with certain physiological developments of the various system of the body. See, first one, physiological factors determining strength. The muscle strength is defined as the greatest amount of the force that muscles can produce in a single and maximal effort. This depends on the following physiological factors: muscle cross sectional area, types of muscle fibers, muscle length, age, gender, point of tendon insertion, nerve impulses, energy level. The first one, muscle cross sectional area. The cross sectional area is generally measured with girth measurement. The muscle having bigger cross sectional area has more strength because larger muscles have better quality of actin and myosin filaments. Even number of cross bridges is also more in bigger muscles. Second one, types of muscle fibers. The strength largely depends on the types of muscle fibers. Human muscles have two basic types of, first one, slow twitch muscle fiber and fast twitch muscle fibers. Next, third one, muscle length. All individuals have different length of the muscles. Persons with relatively long muscles have greater potential for developing size and strength than persons with relatively short muscles. Next one, age. The age cannot be controlled, but people of all ages can develop their muscles. However, the rate of strength of the muscles in more in the age from 10 to 20 years. The strength changes with increases in the age of after 20 years of age. Next one, gender. It is well known that gender does not affect the quality of our muscles, but does influence the quantity. The men and women have similar tissues, but men have bigger muscle size leading to better strength as compared to women. That is why most men are stronger than women. Next one, point of tendon insertion. Muscle strength is influenced by the point of tendon insertion of individual. For example, two persons have same muscles length, but point of tendon insertion is different. The tendon insertion attached with the respective bone produces better strength. Next one, nerve impulses. The muscular strength also depends on the nerve impulses and number of motor units. The intensity and number of motor units determine the muscular strength. Next one, energy level. The energy of muscular contraction is derived from the breaking down and phosphogenesis, ATP and CP. The strength also depends on level of phosphogenesis stores in the body. Particularly, it is required more for strength endurance. Next, second one, physiological factors determining speed. Speed is defined as the maximal speed that can be reached by part or all of the body. Basically, it is the rate of successive movements of the body. It is the ability of the body to perform similar movements consequently at the fastest rate. In few sports, the body as whole does not move fast, but a part of the body does. The best example is baseball pitching. In this, action and attains more speed to accelerate the ball while lower body remains slow. There are following physiological factors that determining speed. See, first one, nervous system and its mobility. composition of muscle fibers. Muscle fibers already discussing two types, slow twitch muscle fibers and fast twitch muscle fibers. Next, flexibility. Next one, phosphogens stores. First one, nervous system and its mobility. To generate more speed, the muscles have to contract and relax at maximal speed. These actions are possible when motor impulses from central nervous system. The speed of the person largely depends on mobility of nervous system. Second one, composition of muscle fibers. Skeletal muscles is made up of bundles of individual muscle fibers. These fibers contain many myofibrils. It is generally accepted that muscle fibers types can broken down into main following types. See, first one, slow twitch muscle fibers. Second one, fast twitch muscle fibers. Generally, the body has equal percentage of slow twitch and fast twitch fibers in most of the muscles used for movement. But having more fast twitch fibers can be an asset to a sprinter for better speed. Next, third one, flexibility. Flexibility is referred as range of movement around the joints. Every individual has different level of flexibility. Better flexibility around joints gives more range of movement to the muscle, which can be helpful in generating better speed. Last one, phosphogens stores. To exhibit speed performance, muscles need high amount of the energy. The amount of phosphogens stores in the muscle determine the speed movements. Next, third one, physiological factors determining endurance. Endurance is the ability of the body to work for long time without getting fatigue. The following are the physiological factors determining endurance: maximal oxygen uptake, pulmonary diffusion, cardiac output, blood volume, lactate threshold, hydration, slow twitch muscle fibers. The first one, maximal oxygen uptake, VO2. Maximum oxygen uptake refers to the highest rate at the oxygen can be take up and consumed by the body during intense exercises. The body gets energy from continuous production of ATP. These reactions involve mitochondrial respiration, which depends on continuous oxygen availability. Better oxygen intake can be major factor determining the endurance of a person. Second one, pulmonary diffusion. The most important function of lungs is to transfer oxygen from the atmosphere to the blood and removal of carbon dioxide from the body. Pulmonary diffusion is the exchange of oxygen and carbon dioxide between the lungs and blood. Better pulmonary diffusion leads to better endurance. Third one, cardiac output. Cardiac output refers to the efficiency of the heart to circulate blood to the body per minute. It is calculated by the product of heart rate and stroke volume, which is reported as liter per minute. A person having better cardiac output lead to better circulation, and this leads to for better oxygen transport. The better cardiac output yields to better endurance. Next one, blood volume. For endurance activities, the working muscle demands considerably more oxygen and nutrients. The oxygen is transported through blood. Regular and intense endurance training increases blood volume. This determines the endurance of the person. Next one, lactate threshold. The lactate threshold refers to the intensity of exercise at which there is an immediate increase in the blood lactate levels. Every individual have different lactate threshold. Better lactate threshold leads to better endurance. In 1996, McCardell, Ketch and Ketch did study and found that the untrained endurance people's the lactate threshold occurs at approximately 50 to 60% of maximum uptake volume. However, the trained persons or trained athletes had lactate threshold to 75% to maximum uptake volume. Even it was found that in some world classes endurance runners, it found 80 to 90% of the maximum uptake volume. Next one, hydration. Endurance activities often result to exercise sweating. This result in substantial fluid loss of impaired endurance performance. Dehydration leads to the decrease in endurance. Hydrating athletes is very important, especially in the marathon runners. Last one, slow twitch muscle fibers. The more slow twitch muscle fibers yields better energy to the exercising muscles during endurance activity. With training, one can change the proportion of the fiber between fast and slow twitch muscle fibers. However, studies indicate that these changes are not permanent. The percentage of slow twitch muscle fibers determine the endurance of the person. Next, fourth one, physiological factors determining flexibility. Flexibility is defined the maximum range of movement possible at the joint. See, some factors determining flexibility. First one, structure of the joint, elasticity of ligaments, muscular strength, strength ability of muscles, age and gender. The first one, structure of the joint. A joint is formed where two or more bones come in close contact in the body and are attached to each other by ligaments or cartilage. There are established ranges that are considered normal for various joints in the body. The movement around the joint depends on its type. For example, shoulder joint has greater mobility than knee joint. The flexibility depends on type of joint to great extent. Regular exercise, particularly performed in childhood, improves structure of the joint and results in better flexibility. Next, so second one, elasticity of ligaments. A ligament is the connective tissues that connect two or more bones around the joint. The range of movement around the joint depends on the elasticity of ligaments. It has been observed that due to long-term training, the elasticity of ligaments increases and that leads to the better flexibility. Next one, muscular strength. The range of movement of the joint depends on the strength of related muscles. Stronger muscles can pull the bones of the joint more. This results in better flexibility. Next, fourth one, stretchability of muscles. The regular exercise keeps the muscles stretchability in good forms and results in better flexibility. The antagonist muscles have to stretch for more range of movement around the joint. Next one, age. It is well known that children have better flexibility than adults. Flexibility is strongly correlated with age. This range of motion around the joint is affected by the health of the tendons and ligaments and muscles surrounding the joint. Some diseases like arthritis and osteoporosis caused due to old age can reduce the flexibility. Since flexibility is not slowly determined by age, and elderly people can exhibit great flexibility if they adapt healthy fitness routines. Last one, gender. Females exhibit better flexibility than males. There is anatomical differences that leads to is, for example, in females the width of the pelvis is wider and more circular, giving greater range of motion. Next one, effect of exercise on cardiorespiratory system. Whenever we perform any strenuous exercise, the demand of oxygen increases. Therefore, during exercise, the supply of oxygen to the muscles is the urgent need. Is oxygen cannot be stored in muscles. Hence, heart functions faster into increases the systemic circulation as well as the pulmonary circulation. Next, effects on cardiovascular system, immediate effects of exercises. First one, heart rate during exercises, blood pressure during exercises, stroke volume during exercises, cardiac output during exercises. The first one, heart rate during exercises. The heart rate increases with the intensity of exercises. The normal heart rate is 72 beats per minute and can rise up to 200 beats per minute. It is also observed that increases of heart rate is comparatively slow in trained persons. Second one, blood pressure during exercises. During strenuous exercise, systolic blood pressure increases, whereas diastolic blood pressure changes to the small extent. Next one, stroke volume during exercises. The normal stroke volume between 70 ml to 80 ml per beat. In trained male athletes during strenuous activity, it may reach up to 160 ml per beat. Next one, cardiac output during exercises. The cardiac output also increases with physical exercise, because with exercise heart rate as well as stroke volume increases. Next one, long term effects of exercises. Heart size, heart rate, stroke volume, cardiac output, increase in number of functioning capillaries, coronary circulation, blood pressure, total blood volume and cholesterol level. The first one, heart size. The effect of exercise is a well established fact. The heart hypertrophy takes place in endurance trained athlete. Cardiac hypertrophy is found more. The bigger heart is also called athletic heart. The increase in the size the increase in the size of heart takes place with an increased left ventricular cavity. It found to be more in distance runners and swimmers. However, in wrestlers, weightlifters and throwers, the thickness of the left ventricle walls in the increased. Next, second one, heart rate. As a result of long term training program, the resting heart rate decreases. The basic heart rate is less in trained persons as compared to untrained persons. The basic heart rate is less in endurance trained athletes due to increases in heart size and stroke volume. Third one, stroke volume. Stroke volume is higher in trained persons as compared to untrained persons. In an untrained persons, the normal stroke volume 70 to 75 ml per beat, whereas endurance trained persons athletes have normal stroke volume 100 to 115 ml per beat. The maximal stroke volume for endurance trained athletes may reach up to 170 ml per beat, whereas maximal stroke volume for untrained persons can reach up to 120 ml per beat. Next, fourth one, cardiac output. The cardiac output is more in trained athletes as compared to untrained persons. The maximal cardiac output may reach a value of 30 liters per minute in trained persons, whereas maximal cardiac output in untrained persons can reach up to 20 liters per minute. Next one, increase in number of functioning capillaries. Training leads to increase in number of functioning capillaries, resulting into better systemic circulation. Next one, coronary circulation. Training has great impact on the coronary circulation. It is observed that coronary circulation is better in trained as compared to untrained persons. Next one, blood pressure. It is evident from many studies that the blood pressure in the trained persons is more stable as compared to untrained persons. Next one, total blood volume. Total blood volume in untrained is less as compared to trained persons. Average untrained young adults may have 5.7 liters blood volume, whereas trained persons 6.4 liters. Next one, cholesterol level. Many studies have explained that exercises might lower blood pressure level and reduce the cholesterol level. In the walls of arteries, trained persons have less cholesterol level as compared to untrained persons. Next one, effect of exercise on respiratory system. The demand of oxygen increases due to participation in physical activity. During exercise, the level of carbon dioxide increases in blood. Carbon dioxide is acidic in medium and stimulates respiratory center in the medulla oblongata. Like this, the breathing frequency increases. Next, immediate effects of exercises. The following are the effects of exercise on respiratory system, respiratory rate and oxygen transport. First one, respiratory rate. During the exercise, the increased demand of the oxygen increases the rate of breathing. The normal resting breathing rate of an adult is about 14 per minute. During strenuous exercise, it can increase up to 32 per minute. Next one, oxygen transport. The demand of oxygen is increased during the exercise, and this is transported to the muscle by increases in respiration rate during the exercises. The sympathetic nerve stimulates the veins to constrict. This constriction leads to return more blood towards the heart. This can increase the total stroke volume of the heart by 30 to 40%. Next, long term effects of exercise. Due to long term training, many adaptational developments take place, which can be listed. Example, strength of diaphragm increases, strength of intercostal increases, number of functioning bronchioles increases. Next, fourth one, number of functioning alveoli increases. Next, this development leads to following developments. First one, vital capacity increases, tidal volume, inspiratory reserve volume and expiratory reserve volume, diffusion capacity increases, residual volume, second wind and maximum uptake increases, VO2. First one, vital capacity increases. Vital capacity is defined as the maximum amount of air that a person is capable of expelling from their lungs. After maximum inhalation, normal adults have a vital capacity between 3 to 5 liters. However, exercising increases the vital capacity to 5 to 6 liters. Next one, tidal volume. The volume of air breathed in and out at rest is known as the tidal volume. This is found to be about about 500 ml in a averagely built healthy young adults. The tidal volume also increases after long term training. Next one, inspiratory reserve volume, IRV, and expiratory reserve volume, ERV. The lungs are capable of inhaling additional amount of the air during a deep inspiration. This amount of air that can be inhaled in addition to the tidal volume is known as the inspiratory reserve volume. On the other side, in deep and forceful expiration, the lungs are capable of exhaling a volume which exercise. The tidal volume is known as the expiratory reserve volume. In a healthy young adults, measures about 3 liters and expiratory reserve volume is approximately 1.3 to 1.5 liters. The adaptational changes due to exercise also leads to increases the inspiratory reserve volume and expiratory reserve volume. Next, fourth one, diffusion capacity increases. In trained persons, diffusion through alveoli capillary membrane is increased. This development is mainly due to increase in the number of functioning alveoli and pulmonary capillaries. Next one, residual volume. The lungs do not collapse completely following in maximal expiration. A certain volume of air remains with the lungs and known as residual volume. In transport, it is found to be less. Next one, second wind. The stress due to second wind is found to be less in trained persons as compared to untrained persons. Last one, maximum uptake volume, VO2 max increases. VO2 is referred as maximum volume of oxygen that can be utilized by the human body in 1 minute during maximal exercise. However, in the trained persons, it can increases up to 80 to 90 ml per minute. Next one, effect of exercise on muscular system. Due to participation in long term training programs, the development of muscular system takes place. The training develops the capacity of an individual. This effect depends upon the type of training given to an individual. Now, following are the effects of exercise on muscular system. Strength of the muscle increases, actin and myosin filaments, endomyosin, perimyosin, epimyosin and sarcolemma. This is all muscle names. First one, strength of the muscle increases. By strength training, many developments of the muscle take place. Hypertrophy of muscle take place due to the thickening of the following parts of the muscles: actin and myosin filaments, endomyosin, perimyosin, epimyosin and sarcolemma. Next, second one, muscular endurance increases. Endurance training also induces adaptations in skeletal muscles. The capacity for prolonged working increases due to the following reasons. First one, size and number of mitochondria, content of myoglobin, capacity of glycogen, number of capillaries. The first one, size and number of mitochondria. The most important training effect of the endurance training is the increase of mitochondrial functions. The size and the number of mitochondria in muscle cells is increased. Next one, content of myoglobin. It has been observed that the myoglobin contents of the muscle are more in trained persons than in untrained persons. Next, third one, capacity of glycogen. It is found that the capacity of glycogen stores around the more in trained persons as compared to untrained persons. Last one, number of capillaries. The number of capillaries per muscle increases with the long term training, which gives enhanced blood supply to the muscle. Next one, anaerobic capacity increases. It has been observed that increases in the ATP stores occurs with the long term training program. ATP concentration in muscles is very important during periods of anaerobic work. Next, very important, sports injuries. Sports injuries classifications: soft tissue injuries, abrasion, contusion, laceration, incision and sprain and strain. Next, bone and joint injuries, dislocation, fractures, stress fractures, green streak, comminuted, transverse, oblique and impacted. And causes, prevention and treatment. First, discussing about classification of sports injuries. Sports injuries are very common in this competitive world. Mainly in contact sports, the occurrence of sports injuries are more. The classification of sports injuries is mainly based on causes and types of tissues. The sports injuries are mainly classified in two categories. First one, direct classification due to cause, and second one, classification due to type of tissues. First one, classification due to cause. Sports injuries are classified due to cause of injuries and explained. First one, direct injuries, indirect injuries, overuse injuries. First one, direct injuries. Direct injuries are caused due to impact of the external forces. Example, a hockey player receiving a bruise from being struck on the face by a stick during a game. The another example is collision of two footballers. Next, second one, indirect injuries. Indirect injuries typically involve the athlete himself by damaging the soft tissues such as the ligaments, tendons or muscles. Generally, sprain and strain are the examples. Sprinters gets hamstring strain while sprinting. Next one, overuse, stretching or third one, overuse. This type of injury caused due to overuse or construct the overuse of the body parts. Example, tennis elbow in javelin throwers. The other example, stress fractures and athletes training for long distance runners. Stress fractures are caused by the cannot overuse of the bones of the legs in road running events. Second one, classification due to type of tissues. The sports injuries are also classified according to the type of tissues, soft tissues and hard tissues. First one, soft tissue injuries. This kind of injuries like sprain, strain, abrasion, laceration, etc. in which it is caused on soft tissues of the skin, muscles, tendons, synovial membrane, fibrous tissues, fat, blood vessels, nerves and ligaments in the body. Example, sprained ankle, soft tissues injuries occur more than hard tissue injuries. Second one, hard tissue injuries. Hard tissue injuries occur in bones and cartilages. Example, fractures. Next one, common causes of sports injuries. In this competitive world, the athletic want to achieve their best, and this the reason that sports injuries are prevalent. The following are the causes of sports injuries. First one, improper warming up, overuse, sudden stopping or twisting, improper sports equipments, fatigue, poor training, improper development of muscles, falls, lack of safety equipments. The first one, improper warming up. Warming up makes the muscles more pliable. Most of the stretching exercises are done during the warm-up session. Improper warm-up can lead to any injury. Strain in the muscle is often caused due to straining and activity without properly warming up and muscles. Second one, overuse. Repeatedly use of muscles and its overuse may cause of sports injuries like tennis elbow in tennis players. Stress fractures is another example of the injury caused due to overuse. Third one, sudden stopping or twisting. In many sports like basketball, gymnastics, hockey and football, sudden stopping or twisting is required. Generally, sudden stopping or twisting can cause us injuries like ankle sprain. Fourth one, improper sports equipments. Use of improper sports equipments can also be a causes of sports injury. In case of improper shoes may cause us injury in distance runners. Using heavy requirements may lead to the lower back pain. Next one, fatigue. When fatigued muscles are given strenuous activity, then the became a common causes of muscles pulls. Proper recovery must be there. Next one, poor training. Sports injuries are most commonly caused by poor training methods. Disproportion in intensity and load may cause us injury. Improper scheduling of training can also lead to an injury. Next one, improper development of muscles. Having some muscles that are very strong and others that are weak can lead to the injury. For example, quadriceps is stronger than hamstring. It can increase the risk of stretched or turn hamstring. Next one, falls. Any athlete can fall in the midst of any activity. In sudden falls, a person puts his or her hands to prevent fall, but is can lead to the wrist sprain. Last one, lack of safety equipment. Safety equipments prevents many injuries, but lack of safety equipments can lead to the severe injury. Next, common prevention of sports injuries. Sports injuries are commonly caused due to overuse, over-twisting, over-stretching, collisions, etc. The injuries can be mild to severe. Most of the injuries are caused due to lack of knowledge. Sports injuries can be prevented to a great extent. The following are the methods should be used to prevent sports injuries. Example, proper warming up, conditioning, protective sports wear, proper footwear, adequate rest, proper use of right techniques, appropriate nutrition, sports equipment and play fields, playing under rules and regulations. Next one, soft tissue injuries, abrasion, contusion, laceration or incision. The first one, abrasion. See this picture. Abrasion is an injury to the surface of skin. It exposes the blood vessels and the superficial layer of skin is scraped up. This injury is commonly caused by sliding or friction. The most common site of the abrasion is knees, palms and elbows. Next one, contusion. Inside the muscle, see this picture, it is superficial injury in which the skin is not broken but often produces bruise. There may be pain, swelling and discoloration of the skin. Generally, contusion is caused due to hitting a blunt of object. Next, third one, laceration or incision. See this picture, traumatic wound injury, traumatic wound repair. See, laceration or incision, it is a tear in any tissues in the body. It may be external or internal. A lacerated wound is often caused by a cut from the sharp object, such as knife, when a ball hits a skin which is over the sharp bone, may create laceration wound. Next, management of abrasion, contusion and or laceration or incision. How to manage? They can be prevented by using protective equipments. Example, volleyball players use padded knee pads. For example, abrasion of knees can be prevented. The treatment should begin with washing the wound immediately with soap and water. A cotton gauze of rinsed with antiseptic lotion can be used to remove any pieces of loose debris from the wound. After drying it, apply antibiotic ointment. Bandage the area if the wound is still bleeding. In case of minor injury, the wound can be left unmanaged. The scab should not be removed, otherwise it will start bleeding again. In case of profuse bleeding pressures, bandage must be applied before stitching of wound. In case of contusion, ice can be applied on injured parts. Next, sprain. Management of abrasion, contusion and laceration incision. Sprain and strain. See, what is a strain? A strain is an injury to the muscle or the tendon. Sprain, ligament. A sprain is an injury to the ligament. Strain, tendon, sprain, ligament. Sprain. See, first one, sprain. It is an injury to a joint in which some of the ligaments are stretched or torn. The consist of the pain, swelling, tenderness. In swells, sprains, the joint usually swells rapidly. Pain is more felt in the case of movement of the affected. Second one, strain. Strain is injury of muscle, generally known as the muscle pulls. This injury causes tearing or overstretching of muscle fibers. It is more common in sprinters, mostly sudden overstretching in the athletes. Athletes causes tearing of quadriceps or hamstring muscles. Tearing of Achilles tendons is also common in sportsmen. The major symptoms of the strain is an acute pain at the time of injury. The muscle may feel stiff. Next, मैनेजमेंट ऑफ डिसलोकेशन. बोन एंड जॉइंट इंजरीज डिसलोकेशन, मैनेजमेंट ऑफ डिसलोकेशन. सॉरी दिस फॉर मिस्टेक. मैनेजमेंट ऑफ डिसलोकेशन, रिडक्शन, इमोबिलाइजेशन, सर्जरी, रिहेबिलिटेशन. फर्स्ट, बोन एंड जॉइंट इंजरीज डिसलोकेशन. ए डिसलोकेशन इज एन इंजरी टू ए जॉइंट ड्यू टू ओवर ट्विस्टिंग. द एंड्स ऑफ द बोन्स आर फोर्स्ड अवे फ्रॉम देयर नॉर्मल पोजिशंस. दिस पेनफुल इंजरी टेम्पररली डिफॉर्म्स एंड इमोबिलाइजेशन जॉइंट्स. जनरली डिसलोकेशन इज मोस्ट कॉमन इन द शोल्डर्स एंड फिंगर्स. द अदर साइड्स ऑफ द डिसलोकेशंस इंक्लूड द एल्बोस, नीज एंड हिप्स. हाउ टू मैनेजमेंट ऑफ द डिसलोकेशन. फर्स्ट वन, रिडक्शन. ड्यूरिंग दिस प्रोसेस द डॉक्टर मे ट्राई सम जेंटल मूवमेंट्स अराउंड द affected joint to help of the bones back into position. In case of severe pain, local anesthetic produces are adapted. Second one, see this picture, immobilization, no movements. After getting the bones at normal position, the joints should be immobilized with the split or sling or several weeks. The time for which slings or split is be used depends on damage to nerves, blood vessels and supporting tissues. Next, third one, surgery. If reduction is not able to settle the joint, then surgical technique can be used to move dislocated bones back into the correct position. Even in case of ruptured nearby blood vessels, nerves or ligaments, surgery is required. Last one, rehabilitation. Rehabilitation process is started after the splint or sling is removed. For the dislocation joints, the rehabilitation exercises should be diagnosed in the such a way a gradual load is given. The aim of the rehabilitation is to restore normal range of motion and strength around the joint. Next, fractures. Fractures is a broken or cracked bone. It is the caused accidentally by a wrenching force. See fractures, stress fracture, Greenstreak fracture, comminuted fractures, transverse fractures, oblique fractures, impacted fracture, open and closed fracture. The first one, stress fracture. See this picture, commonly sprinters or runners. Stress fracture are small cracks, even they are difficult to see an x-ray. They are caused by an repetitive use of the bones and joints. Road running may be the causes of stress fracture. Second one, Greenstreak fractures. This type of fractures generally occur in children. The bones does not break completely. See this picture, arm Greenstreak fractures are more common since many children throw out the arms to catch themselves when they fall. Thus, an arm fractures occur theoretically applying a lot of force on one's bones can also cause a Greenstreak fracture. Next one, comminuted fracture. The bone is broken into small pieces at the site of the fractures. See this picture. Next one, transverse fracture. Transverse fracture means this type of fracture is caused due to breaking of bone at the right of angle with the axis of the bone. See here, all parts of the Greenstreak fractures, spiral, comminuted, transverse and compound fractures. Next one, oblique fractures. See this picture. In this type of fracture, the bone breaks obliquely to the axis. Next one, impacted fracture. An impacted fracture occurs when the broken excites of the bone or jammed together by the forces of the injury. Next one, closed fractures and open fractures. See this picture. Closed fractures, bone will be cracked. Open fractures, bone will be broken or two parts. Open and closed fractures, injury to bone and skin. Sometimes bone may be exposed. However, in closed fractures, the broken bone does not freezes the skin, but internal injury to surrounding tissues may be caused. Next one, first aid. What is the first aid? First aid is the most important and immediate care given to the victim of an accident, injury, sudden illness, or any other medical emergencies. Many people hesitate to give first aid when it is required because of the lack of knowledge. Proper first aid given timely can save the victim's life, especially when the victim is bleeding heavily. First aid also restricts the severity of an injury. The first aid treatment should be administered by the person who had knowledge of the first aid. The first aid treatment should be administered by the person who has knowledge of the first aid. He should refer a victim to a hospital. If the first aid is confused, he or she should not attempt because the wrong treatment can cause us of more damage. Next, first aid aims and objectives. First aid aims: preserve life, prevent deterioration, promote recovery. First one, preserve life. The aim of the first aid is to preserve life by carrying out of emergency first aid procedures. The best example is in case of drawing, performing cardiopulmonary restrictions. Preserving life should be always be the overall aim of the first aiders, keeping in mind that first aider should not put his or her life in danger. Second one, prevent deterioration. The second aim of the first aid is to prevent the victim's condition from the deteriorating any further. For example, in case of compound fractures, use of splints will prevent the fractures bone from moving. Next, last one, promote recovery. Lastly, the last aim of the first aid is to promote recovery by promote emergency medical help. For example, rapidly cooling burnt area will reduce the risk of long-term scarring and encouraging early healing. Next, principles of first aid. First aid is defined as the immediate care given to the actually injured or ill person. It can literally be life-saving, so all of us should follow some basic principles of following: no panic, do no harm, CPR administration, immediate medical help, don't use hydrogen peroxide on cuts or open wounds. The first one, no panic. Panic always causes mistakes. The first aider must remain calm in case of first aid. This will help in settling down and victim. Second one, do no harm. First aider must be swear that what he is going to do would not make matters worse. If he is not sure about the risk of harms of the particular intervention. Next one, CPR administration. CPR can save one's life. It keeps vital organs oxygenated until paramedics arrive. Timely CPR can play a vital role in saving victim's life. Deteriorations of respiration and circulation. CPR means restoration, respiration and circulation can be very helpful. Next one, immediate medical help. It is observed that the risk of dying from the heart attack is greatest in the first 30 minutes after symptoms begin, getting victims to the nearest emergency as quickly as possible can help in saving victim's life. The shorter time taken to shift the victims to the emergency, the more likely the best treatment can be applied. Risk and removal of the victims in the shortest possible time without aggravating exciting health situation is the most important principle of the first aid. Last one, don't use hydrogen peroxide on cuts or open wounds. It is more irritating to tissues than is helpful. Soap and water and some kinds of bandage are best. Objectives. The most important objectives of first aid is to save life. For survival, air is a crucial component. So one of the first factor that need to be taken account is whether the airways are blocked. If the airways are blocked, clearing the blockage should be the immediate concern. Without oxygen, brain damage will be happen within 4 minutes. Timely CPR can save the life of person. The second objective of minimize aggravation of injuries or prevent them from the further deterioration. Immediate action and remove the injured individual away from the objects. That may be hazards is very important in addition to the this composition bandage is done to the prevent excessive blood loss. Depending upon the nature of wound, the treatment is recommended. For example, for minor burns, cool the burning area by running it is under cool running water for a minimum 10 to 15 minutes. Next, cover the burn with the sterile gauze bandage and provide the injured individual with over the counter pain reliefs. Keep an eye out of the infections. Next, some discussing about MCQ questions. First question, cardiac output refers to the efficiency of the heart to circulate blood per minute. Second question, the normal heart rate of an healthy person is 72 per beats. Question number 3, the value of normal stroke volume 70 to 80 mL per beat. Fourth question, the normal breathing rate is 14. Normal adults or young adults, 14 per beat per minute. Next, fifth question, the value of vital capacity of normal adults is 3 to 5 liters. Question number 6, the number of fitness components are 5. Strength, speed, endurance, flexibility, coordinative abilities. Next question, heart tissue injuries is related to bones. Next question, in case of drawing, what kind of first is needed? CPR. Next question, sprain is injury to sprain, ligaments, tendons. Next question, the energy of muscular contraction is derived from the ATP and CP. Next question, the pulmonary defusion takes place in lungs. Next question, stroke volume during the strenuous activity is 160 ml per beat. This is trained persons. Next question, the endurance athletes have bigger ventricle. Last question, the long term training does not change none of the above. See question, the long term training does not change none of the above. Thank you all.